Morbid, tell me a little bit about your involvement in the creative arts in Teesside.
Well, I run the Blacklight Engine Room, which is a press and a live event. We've been doing that for 10 years. Prior to that, I've been writing poetry, prose and stuff since 1983. First got involved properly through Bob Beegery and Andy Willoughby, because they were in their Exibon events, and there was no way I was turning up. And he was going, "Come on!" He was badgering me for 3 years before I finally went down. And from then, it's sort of, cannonballing. I just know practically everyone in the Teesside art scene.
So, whereabouts do these events take place?
At the moment, the last couple of years have been at Off the Ground Cafe in town. Prior to that, we were in the Python Gallery. But we've got to leave there because cafes kept closing, and where we are in town is more central for people, and they've got better coffee, so good coffee's always a thing.
Absolutely. So, what kind of people do you get coming along? How do people get involved?
Well, we get, quite a variety of people from, our oldest member was born during the war. So she remembers actually World War II, to some people who were still late teens. We get a good number of people who'll just sit and listen, because you go to some events and you can just see the poets just queuing to get on, and that's all they're interested in is like doing their bit. But we've got a good mix of people who don't want to listen. I mean, do just want to listen, and others who want to get up and, read. They're a good bunch, even if I do say so myself. Obviously, I wouldn't tell them that there, because it just goes straight in their heads,
Absolutely. Keep your audience in line.
Yeah, well, I do. Constantly insulting them.
But they like that kind of thing.
Yeah, they're kinky.
Yeah. Nice. Nice touch. So, mainly in Middlesbrough, is it? You don't
It's
have
a
anything
We've
else?
done one outside event in a little place in Newcastle, but it was a bit weird because I knew there were certain things I would say as a host in Middlesbrough that I couldn't say up in Newcastle, because they're a bit touchy, but I mean, the Blacklight Engine Room, in the past we've done a few library events in Stockton and Norton, even Gisborough, but it's usually based in Middlesbrough. I get out with my friend Harry, who helps with the press. We travel a bit reading, so pushing the press that way through our booklets, and the fact that me and Harry are great poets, even if we do say so ourselves.
Well, there's no point, I think, doing anything if you don't have some kind of confidence in
No.
using. Not that all art needs to be great to be worthwhile. I think there's a lot to be said for just making art for its own purpose, for your own state of mind, for a kind of psychological outlet as much as anything.
Oh, definitely. I mean, that's one of the good things about what I do. I mean, because I paint as well and do make unlistenable music. And they're all just ways to get out what's in me, because it's like I've got a certain amount of like angsty grrr, which I can't do anything with unless I'm screaming in a mic or occasionally painting. Whereas my writing's a lot more considered. The prose is, the poetry is a lot more immediate about where I am. And, I always tell people that they should, even if they don't consider themselves writers or poets, writing's a brilliant thing just for putting down how you're feeling. Even if there's no technical whatever there, if you can, the better you are at expressing yourself, the better you are at untying the knots in your head, kind of thing.
Definitely. I mean, that's how I started off. I was part of a theatre production company, and when we did our show, it was a 24-hour long play called The Warp. Compendium Books in Camden were good enough to give us their basement to rehearse in. We kept the space after the play, and so we used to do all kinds of workshops and stuff down there and performances. I remember Jeff Merrifield did Crap's Last Tate. We worked through Robert Anton Wilson's Prometheus Rising, things like that. And we also did Julia Cameron's The Artist's Way. And a lot of that, was quite problematic. But the morning pages I thought was brilliant. And I just started doing that. And I've now got over 50 A5 ring bound journals full of writing. Didn't matter how good or bad it was. It was just you had to write 3 pages a day without stopping. And that was certainly what started me as a writer and has become my source material for most of the things that I'm writing now. Even if you don't think it's any good at the time, it might come in handy later on.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I do a fair bit of my working out when I'm walking to town. So it's like if I'm mulling over something, the act of walking usually helps clear it up. So, I mean, I always carry a notebook with me in my side pocket. So whenever I go, I can just, stop like a loony in the street and start writing it down.
Really good advice. Again, that's the other thing that I do. I walk.
Yeah.
Like if you're sat there in front of your computer trying to formulate it, it doesn't seem to work. And then the moment you walk.
Well, yeah, I walk into, I used to walk in town a couple of days a week. And, I'm a local historian. So one of the things I do is I walk around and just see if there's anything I've not noticed when I'm walking. And just, I like walking. I don't like so much being out among people, but the walking bit I really do enjoy is, it's really therapeutic.
So do you want to tell us a little bit more about your work as a historian?
Well, been researching Middlesbrough history since 2012, seriously. That was because, I used to drink a hell of a lot. And I stopped drinking in 2012, just like stopped, full stop. So I had all this extra energy because I wasn't hungover all the time. So I became a volunteer at the archives the following year. I think I did my first walk in 2013. So just like digging into things. And it's, I'm really interested in how the town's grown, the names of the streets. I mean, it all ties in a lot of it with me being an artist, I think, because I'm interested in the origins of the names. I've also dug in more the arts and culture side of things than a lot of the historians have previously done. So I've done a lot of work on the Winter Garden, which was in town, purely because it was, more or less forgotten about. But also Florence Bell, despite being very paternalistic in her attitude toward the poor people, really was interested in trying to get bring them some form of culture. It keeps me busy. I've got quite an obsessive frame of mind, so digging into things that other people haven't bothered with. At the moment, I'm just pulling together a detailed Z of the St. Hilda's area of Middlesbrough, which was the original Middlesbrough. But it's going to be like a two-part thing. So there's like a text side, which will have all the streets, but exactly where they were in position to other streets rather than just they were here. And all the little yards that were dotted around town, which nobody's pinpointed previously, they're all going to be in. Then second half's going to have some maps, photographs and things like that.
Brilliant. Yeah, so I'm kind of interested in seeing where the arts can cross over, because I know JT does historic walks as well, and I've been quite interested in having dramatizations along the way, or even like projections onto buildings, and seeing how we can actually turn these into almost like performance walks.
Yeah, well, I do an arts and culture walk, which sometimes starts outside Mima and goes to St. Hilda's, or the opposite way around. There's a lot, especially the Victorian times, which I've found out a lot, but there's a quite interesting subculture of, like, one of the fellas I've researched, William White Collins Seymour, he came up from the Midlands, and he wrote a series of tracts in the 1860s, just basically powering bile on the members of the Middlesbrough Council.
Sorry, you just broke up a bit there, Morbid. Sorry, he just wrote, broke up there. He wrote a series of
tracts, like pamphlets, just basically slagging off the council, especially John Dunning. So he's a really interesting character who I've done a fair bit of research on. But yeah, it's somehow they've survived. Somebody donated them to the library. So all these booklets he wrote about members of the council are there. And he's obviously an educated fella because just the way he slags people off is brilliant, you know. And they give all the various town members belittling names and things. But digging into him, I found out certain things like the Tommy ticket, which was, it was illegal at the time. You know, one of the major sort of people on the council had a deal with Bolko and Vaughan, two other major people, where they didn't get paid their workers. They had to get paid in tickets. They could only use it as shop. So I found that out just by Googling what a Tommy ticket was, because that's what he called him. There's a whole seedy, you know, underworld of like corruption and stuff in the 1870s.
Wow. Well, this is fantastic. Well, I think it's brilliant that people are looking into the history of our local area and bringing it to the forefront, those forgotten bits of history. I'd love to see where we can cooperate on that, you know, over the years to come. So I think that's the kind of thing that I would think that can get a bit of funding, can't it?
Yeah, well, I think it'd make a good play that William Seymour and John Dunning, just because Dunning was a Quaker, very bolshy, you know, didn't suffer fools gladly, and was apparently done for assault at one point. Basically, just came from nowhere, and within a couple of years, he was the mayor of Middlesbrough. And Seymour's come up from the Midlands with a very shady past. And as soon as he's landed in Middlesbrough, he just seems to have got into trouble. So it's a backwards and forwards. And I thought it'd make a good, them two arguing their own points. Yeah. Because yeah. Dunning, he says a lot of things about Dunning, a lot of it which is purely libelous. But some other researchers have looked into it, and there was a lot of corruption going on. You know, they were all helping each other out, all the Quakers and stuff, you know.
Not much changes, even though things change, do they?
Yeah, no. I read a quote.
More things stay the same.
Well, it is. There's a quote that Seymour has about Dunning, which I used to read out to people. I'd say, who does this remind you of? And without fail, everyone went, it's and one of our previous mayors who shall remain nameless. But everyone recognises that character from the 1800s, you know.
There we go. Maybe art this time is going to break us out of the cycle. That's what we can trust in, our art. Morbid, it's been lovely to speak to you. I'm sorry, I'm a bit puffy-eyed. I'm still recovering from wasp sting allergy. I can barely hear. It's affected my hearing as well and my balance and everything else. So it's nice to...
Give you a good excuse to ignore the kids. Sorry, I didn't hear. I've got allergies.
Oh, brilliant. And I hope to see you out in the actual world in the near future.
Well, as soon as I can start having walks, I'll let you know.
Brilliant. Do come and see what we can collaborate on there and just enjoy being it out in the open air and learning some history. All right. Thanks.
Ta-ta. Bye. Yeah.